It's my pleasure to introduce to you today Professor Vladimir Vapnik. He is, of course, there is no need to introduce him, actually. He is one of the co-founder of learning theory, of statistical learning theory. And, of course, he is also Emeritus Professor of Royal Holloway, University of London. Vladimir developed further his theory, and it's quite a substantial piece of work, which probably will take quite a time. Vladimir, if you want to have some breaks between different chapters, let us know. It's not a problem to have a small break if you want to on. And but basically, it's over to you to go ahead with this.
Okay. Can I start?
Yes, indeed.
So the first part of my talk is statistical foundation of learning theory. What is this theory of generalization? And let me start with the main question of statistical learning theory. The question is, when using IID observations, one can approximate function which minimize loss functional by the function which minimize average loss, empirical loss. What we're talking about, we would like to minimize expected loss. We don't have information about probability measure, but we have data, x1, y1, xl, yl. So when using this data, we can minimize empirical loss. This is formal number two. And the function which minimizes empirical loss accept of approximation of the function which minimizes expected loss. It is usual idea of almost all learning algorithms. And the first theorem says that it is possible if and only if it is necessary and sufficient condition, uniform convergence over set of functions takes place. When you're minimizing something, you should describe admissible set of functions in which you minimize. You cannot minimize without given admissible set of functions. And we will talk a lot about admissible set of functions. But if you minimize an admissible set of functions, then it is necessary and sufficient that uniform convergence takes place over set of admissible functions. It is supremum in front of difference between expected loss and empirical loss. Okay. The next theorem says that uniform convergence exists if and only if the VC dimension of the set of function is finite. So if you don't know probability measure, you know only admissible set of functions, then it is necessary and sufficient to have VC dimension finite in order to minimize empirical loss and be sure that you're doing something reasonable. I hope that all of you know what is VC dimension, but this is a definition of this dimension for set of indicator functions. That means function which takes two values, zero and one, and set of real value function. For set of indicator functions, this dimension is defined as a maximal number of vectors that can be shuttered. That means separated in all two to the kh possible subset, using indicator function of this admissible set of functions. If such h vector exists for any number h, the dimension is infinite. This is the dimension of the set of real value function. It is just this dimension of the set of indicator function where to set of function fx alpha added value b and in front you see indicator theta is 0, 1 indicator. So that is VC dimension. And then there is a theorem which says if function is bounded and L exceed H, then there exists a bound. The largest deviation between empirical loss and expected loss is bounded by formula number 4. But formula number 4 not as important as formula number 5. It is equivalent setting statement of the formula number 4, because if I will make right hand side of formula number 4 equal to eta, I can solve everything with respect to epsilon, and then I can claim the following equivalent theorem. This probability 1 minus eta for all functions of admissible set simultaneously, inequality holds. And because it true simultaneously for all functions, I can choose the function which minimize right-hand side of this inequality, and that it will minimize expected value of for the function. So in all textbook and monograph, except of mine, describing VC theory, people refer to rough bound 5, where the second term, the confidence interval, has order of magnitude H over L. H over L, and that is rough bound. And people talking that VC bound is not good enough because they use this, the worst bound, which is in my book. In my book, in all my books are usually considered equivalent bound. And that's precise theory of bound. Along with bound, which is rough bound, the following bound take place. It is bound about uniform relative one-sided convergence. There are no modulus in numerator and square root from expected loss in denominator. And that is bounded by the bound number 7. And again, we can have a claim which is equivalent to bound number 7 with probability 1 minus eta simultaneously for all functions of admissible set, the inequality holds true. Again, this expected loss is bounded by empirical loss plus confidence interval. But this confidence interval depends on value of empirical loss, S of L. When S of L is very small, equal to 0, it will be not square root from H over L, but H over L. And it is a huge difference. And you will see that all practical algorithms are based on this formula, not on rough formulas. And next theorem, number 5, I put it in red because these two theorems, number 4 and number 5, makes all the difference in learning theory. And it says that if you have a linear set of functions, what means linear? It is inner product of coefficients of W over X, and here W and X in n-dimensional space. And W is parameters of the function in the set 9, then the following theorem holds true. Let X belong to Rn, and X is bounded by sphere with square of radius a, and W bounded with sphere of radius square b. Then we see dimension h of the set of linear indicator functions. You see it's theta in front of the linear functions, has a bound which is smallest from two values, n, which is dimensionality of space, and ab, which is smaller. It is bound for the C dimension. And from this, you can see that the C dimension of linear set of function could be much smaller than dimensionality of the space. So a couple of years ago appears articles about double descent, which demonstrate neural net. Double descent, and people claim that it is something special for neural net. Nothing at all, because when you see this smallest of two values, the first descent happened when you're increasing n, and you will see descent on that increasing bound on h. And second descent comes when you continue to increase number of free parameters, and in play coming this part a, b. So this is why happened double descent. And Cherkasky and his students, they demonstrate that you can absorb double descent on support vector machines. It is general, it is property of statistical theory, nothing to do with this. But again, structural risk minimization principle, it is one of the main principles in statistical theory, because if you have set of function, admissible set of function, you can create structure of the set of function. You can construct the smallest subset of function, then you have nested subset of function. Every subset with higher number is include previous subsets, so the C dimension increasing. Why you doing so? Because your goal is to minimize this accurate bound, which is on the top of the slide, and you minimizing over two parameters, over H and over empirical loss. So first you choosing subset, you choosing H, and then you in this subset of function pick up the function which minimize empirical loss. That is the way how it works. And by the way, SVM was constructed on this principle. That is all about VC theory. So the main remark that if you will try to learn VC theory from the textbook except of mine, you will not find these two main theorems. And as you will see, these two theorems play a crucial role in learning algorithms. So I finished first part, and I would like to start second part. If you have one or two questions, I'm ready to answer. Okay, I think that there are no questions. L2 norm SVM and VC compression scheme. This is new. Let me explain what is SVM. Let vector X of training set mapped into vector zeta belonging to reproducing kernel Hilbert space of Mercer kernel KX X star. What is Mercer kernel? Mercer kernel, it is positive semi-definite function, and Mercer proved theorem that any positive semi-definite or non-negative semi-definite function can have the following expansion. And this is written on the first line. And this expansion is just describe inner product. So if I will map vector X into vector zeta as square root from L1 phi of X1 and so on. So I will have L dimensional, I have infinite dimensional vectors because my expansion over a set of orthonormal functions which is in Mercer kernel. So the inner product will be exactly kernel, value of kernel, k x phi x j. So if I have this mapping, I know how to compute inner product, even if I will not do mapping. What does SVM? Let us consider whatever written in black, and then we will talk about what adding in red. This dimension defines separating hyperplane in reproducing kernel Hilbert space. Suppose you can separate data with no error. Then you have yi w on zeta y exceed one for all I. What it means that if it first class, this y will be positive one, and w zeta should be positive. If it's second class, w zeta should be negative, and y is negative. If so happened, you construct separating hyperplane. But you constructing separating hyperplane, which is optimal in some sense, which it minimize this functional norm of w. And that is the idea of SVM. Minimize norm of w, separate data with w, which has the smallest norm. But what happens if it's non-separable? Then we did following trick. We subtract from one xi I, it is in red, but we ought to go from functional C sum of xi square. It is a target function. Your target to keep xi as small as is possible and separate hyperplane. And C is coefficients which show how important to keep close to zero your xi. So if you will do that, you always can separate because you can subtract any value xi, but you're trying to keep it small. And you can come to solution, which is w equal alpha I yi zeta I alpha is non-negative. So to find coefficients alpha for optimal separating hyperplane, you should solve equations which is in last line. If it's separable case, you don't need to have whatever written in red. But if it's not separable case, you should minimize this functional which has this extra red term. And that is what is SVM. But now coming new stuff. Solution of alpha defined decision function, which is, as we saw, w multiplied zeta, but you can say theta in front of that, but it will give you positive for one class and negative for another class if you got separable case. But now consider so-called memorizing kernel. What it means? I would like to have a kernel which is sum of two kernels. One of kernel, it is regular kernel, which all of us using in SVM. But second kernel is delta function. What is delta function? Delta function equal to one if xi equal to x. If two values is a function, delta function is it is kernel which has two variables, and it is equal to one if variables coincide, if x pi equal to x, and equal to zero if they does not coincide, x y does not equal to x. And t is some coefficients, positive coefficient, because Mercer kernel should be positive, no negative. It is some coefficients which split between two kernels. But let us consider what does second kernel. It is legal kernel. It is positive definite kernel. It is Mercer kernel. And suppose t equal to zero. The first kernel, which we usually using in SVM, equal to zero. And we use only delta function. The solution, according to the first line, will be sum of yi delta xi x. When you solve equations, alpha I star will be equal, all of them will be equal to one. And what this solution tell you? It tell you that if x equal to xy, you will have one. Then function will give you I, yi. That means exactly what is in training data. If x does not coincide with xi, it will give you zero. That means that second kernel just memorizing training data. It just memorizing training data and doesn't react on the not training data. So the splitting in our GM means generalizing memorizing kernel between generalizing part and memorizing part. Now, if we will use this kernel instead of just one kernel, like in regular SVM, instead of formula this is red 10, you will have the last line or not. You should maximize this functional in non-negative alphas. And because you have memorizing term, it is always separate your data. But it separate your data because you have memorizing term. So now you stay in separable situation. And that changed a lot. You remember great theorem number 4. And this is a bound for this theorem. What it says, that if you separate your data with no error, that means that empirical loss equal to zero, and here it is equal to zero, then expected loss is just bounded this dimension over A, L. Okay, that is our situation. If we will use memorizing kernel, we can use bound, which gives them great number 4. And bound will be just ratio of this dimension over number of observations. But let's see what is the ratio of this dimension. What is this dimension? Then we have taken into account great theorem number 5, which says that this dimension proper is smallest of two values, n and ab. Because we in Hilbert space and it's equal to infinity. So to find this dimension, we should estimate A and estimate B. Consider this kernel, this radial basis function plus delta function. When X coincides with X star, here is zero and exponent give you one. And delta function, according to definition, gives you one or zero when x coincides with x and gives you one. So your a equal one, bounded by one. And what about b? B is inner product of w, multiply with w, which separate your training data. Then you can describe recollect that your kernel is sum of two kernels, and you will have this equation, which is of this line. And what it said, that your VC dimension is split into two parts. VC dimension, which you spend for generalization, I call it HG, and VC dimension spent on your memorization, I call it HM. and you take proportion between this dimension of one sort and another sort. But when you're trying to minimize this dimension, because of great theorem number four, for this theorem, you have bound of generalization just this dimension over L, you can choose such thing which minimize your this dimension. You choose how to split this dimension between memorization and generalization part to get a minimum of this dimension. So, and we call it this dimension compression scheme. According to theorem four, the smallest error bound defined by parameters, even more parameters G and parameter T, such that this dimension, and that means that this expression has a minimum. So, and according to theorem, as I told you, expected error is bounded by this dimension over L. In fact, it is so great because even if it is proportional and you don't know coefficients, it does not matter because everything is monotonically this dimension and your goal is to minimize this dimension. And that is example. We're using GM kernel, and that half solving these problems, and that is test problems, standard test problems, this dimension, which is standard this dimension, and this dimension with memorization kernel. You see 26, 20, it's test result, 22, 17, 17, 24, 22, it is slightly better, but saying no, not worse at least. But what about training data? You see that there's some amount of training data you have, but in the memorization kernel, you have zero of training data. And what it means that when you're solving this problem, which has a lot of training data, your compression scheme is such that you use big part of memorization kernel. When you have, say, small amount of error, you use coefficients in front of memorizing kernel small. So it how to works this dimension compression scheme. But even more, let us consider general form of memorizing kernel. So suppose I will use some of kernels. For example, it's not necessarily random basis. It can be polynomial kernel like x star inner product in degree t and some coefficients which are not negative. And one memorizing kernel, which is a radial basis function. So why I call it memorizing? Because you have free parameter b, and when b goes to infinity, this exponential kernel tends to be delta function. So you have memorizing kernel. And now when you're using this kernel, you can use this compression scheme. You can choose such coefficients. Say here is D, tau and B, which compress this dimension. So maybe you hear that back in 2000, people try to use some of kernel and they invent some alignment scheme. But you don't need alignment scheme. You need just this dimension compression scheme. And this dimension compression scheme related this great theorem number five, and it keep memorization and control in such a way that you will have the small participation, that means the smallest bound. So let me formulate general principle of constructing learning algorithm in reproducing kernel Hilbert space. Use memorizing kernel, separate training data, you can do it because you have memorizing data, and then compress this dimension. So that is second part of my talk. If you have questions, I'm ready to answer. So, Alexis, no questions, as I understand. Okay. Estimation of conditional probability. But whatever stuff I told to you, it was old stuff, at least in the ideas of the old stuff, this dimension, the improved this dimension, and statistical learning theory was old theory. I just show how they work together. But let's start new scheme. What is pattern recognition? You have generator of random vectors X. You have object, which on every X return value Y. This conditional probability Y equal one given X. And you have some admissible set of functions. And your goal absorbing some training data to pick up one function, an admissible set of functions, which minimizes, which gives you the smallest amount of error. That's what we considered before in the first part, two parts of my talk. Now, mathematics tells us that here is a known conditional probability function. Why are you going for a decision function then where unknown is conditional probability function? So let us consider the problem of estimating conditional probability function. But if we know conditional probability function, so our optimal decision rule will be theta from conditional probability minus one over two. What it means, if conditional probability exceeds 1/2, say first class. If conditional probability less than 1/2, say it does not belong to the first class. That is the rule. So if you will do that, you will have solution of our problem which we considered before. But because this conditional probability has many remarkable properties, we can do better than we did before. How to estimate conditional probability function? Formally, conditional probability function, we have to estimate in the set of admissible function using data. So we're looking for smallest, for minimum expected loss, expected risk of this. Minimum gives conditional probability function. And then we can construct true. But this functional, if I will subtract regression, the conditional probability, and odd the regression, I can have, instead of this functional will contain this value and this two. Just I will have four terms, I just combine by two, the square of first two, the square of last two, and this is cross product. And we would like to minimize this functional. If you will go through empirical laws, how usually people doing in regression scheme, we will do not the best estimate. Because as you remember, to have a good estimate with least square method, which is empirical loss of this functional, we should satisfy Gauss Markov conditions. But here we not quite satisfy Gauss Markov condition. And therefore, instead of minimizing this term, which we want to minimize, we minimizing sum of two. So the way of least square method is not very good. Let us do something else. And this is direct estimate of conditional probability. What is conditional probability? It is some function which is exceed zero and smaller than one. And for conditional probability, and whatever I will talk from this moment is can be applied only to pattern recognition. It is not true for regression estimation. What is conditional probability? It is some function between zero and one. And Bayesian formula tell us the probability of one given x multiply on p of x equal probability of one multiply on probability of x y given one. That is Bayesian function, which is true for conditional probability for pattern recognition. Again, whatever theory will come, it comes from Bayesian formula, which I use for this case. Now, if I will take any function, any kernel from L2 and multiply on left and right hand side, the same function, then take integral, I can take y equal one in front of integral because it is get value. So then I can say that if I know right hand side, then conditional probability that is function I is solution of this equation. So the solution of this equation gives me conditional probability. But let us now replace this integral with sum. So before, when I talk about least square method, oh, here, it was not good idea. Because if I will replace integral with sum, I will replace integral with sum over here. And I minimize it two terms, but I won't minimize to one. To do that, we can do it only for pattern recognition case. And in pattern recognition case, we're using Bayesian formulas. And we now replacing integral with sum. And our goal is to solve this equation. Actually, here it will be sum over 1 over L1, where L1 is number of elements of the first class, but P of Y is L1 over L, so you will have this equation. Now our goal in the given set of admissible function to solve this equation. But before I will solve this equation, let me remind you some result from classical statistics. In classical statistics, there exists Watson-Nagarai estimator of conditional probability Y equal one given X. It has a form of that. Actually, Watson-Nagarai estimate is true for any regression function. Why not necessarily 0, 1, but in our case, it is 0, 1. And you will see why I'm talking like that, where G is specific kernel. In our case, it can be any function. But let's take specific kernel. It is Watson-Nagarai. And the specific, say, Gaussian infused. So what we can say about this estimator? This estimator is solution of this equation. What is this equation? It is corrupted equations which we derived. The derived equation, what we want to solve here, g minus xy and f of xy. That's what we want to solve. And here, gx minus xy, f of x, and the same. It looks like very symmetrical, but it is different because I have a sum over y. I can take it in front of sum, and then I will have this Nadaraya-Watson estimator. So Nadaraya-Watson estimator is corrupted solution from the equations which we derived. But our equation is for conditional probability. It is good only for pattern recognition. But Watson-Nadaraya is good for everything, for regression power. So we lost in generality, but we gain in accuracy, as you will see. What means to solve this equation? We should take difference, take a square, and minimize over some probability measure. If I will open this, I will use this square, use this square and cross product. So a simple algebra lead to the expression that I have yy minus f of xy, yj minus f of xj, and some coefficients v, xy, xj, where v, xy, xj is just integral. So if you will do that, you will have some, then you will take integral, but integral will be related only to this function, so we will have this. Let's call it V element of V matrix. So we have this element of V matrix. We again replace our integral with sum, so we can compute this matrix for that. So when we use Gileson, Watson-Nadaraya estimator, Watson-Nadaraya estimator has a parameter of the best kernel, Gaussian kernel, and they spent a lot of work to estimate width parameter. Width. We can use the same kernel because it's some relative to Watson-Nadaraya, but it is something much better because it is specifically for pattern recognition. It is not as general at Watson-Nadaraya, so we can take advantage of that. Therefore, to estimate conditional probability function, one has to minimize quadratic form. So solution of the equation, which is this one. If it will be just diagonal matrix, which is equal one everywhere, when I coincide with J at zero, or in the rest case, it will be least square method. But here it's not least square method. It is minimizing some quadratic form. And that what we got when we consider special case. We just move from least square method to in direction to better method. Let x, y be training data. And let us use notation. Y is vector, L dimensional vectors of all y's. Then I will consider, try to understand what is that. Set of vectors F capital over F over function for admissible function. I will pick up admissible function from admissible function and consider following vector. The first coordinate, it is value of this function in the first point of observation. And the last coordinate is the last point of observation. So for every function in admissible set, I have a vector. I have admissible set of functions, which can create, theoretically can create admissible set of vectors. Now I have V matrix. And I would like to rewrite. I would like to rewrite my equation in the vector form, which is Y minus F of from F, V matrix, instead of diagonal matrix, which was in least square method. And again, Y minus F capital from F small. So we call this minimizer of functional in given set of function, the V estimate of conditional probability because of this V. And this is advantage over least square method because least square method keeps diagonal matrix. And they try to improve, they try to get here something, but I don't want to go to the detailed regression. So, and that is what we would like to do. But let me say that this is very general because I'd say nothing about admissible set of functions. That is true for any admissible set of function. And this is as general as least square method. But now I would like to estimate conditional probability in reproducing kernel Hilbert space with bounded norm. For set of V estimate, we have this form that our solution will be kernel, so some of our kernels, it is reproducing theorem for conditional probability, for reproducing kernel Hilbert space, tell us that this is general form, how it looks as a solution. So conditional probability should look like that. So I want to use, again, matrix notation. A is just coefficients, L dimensional vector. K of X, it is matrix, it is vector of functions. First coordinate is F, K kernel R. X1, X, that is function of X, but fixed first coordinate. And the last coordinate function is fixed XL, and it is function of X. So that is vector function. And this is our key matrix, KI, XI, XJ. So if you will rewrite in this notation, we will have our conditional probabilities A multiply on KX, our function in reproducing kernel Hilbert space. It is matrix of K multiply on A. A is unknown parameters, but parameters, vector parameters, and north of our function F is A transform KA. So now what we want to do, we want to find such A, I call it AV, which minimize this functional subject to this constraint. So what we want minimize our quadratic form instead of least square method in the subclass of function with bounded norm. And we have solution in explicit form, closed form solution, which is defined as A, it is vector, multiply of K of X, it is our vector of functions. And A is just expression on the last line, which is VK plus gamma B dependent parameter B, I is identity matrix VY. So we have closed form solution for conditional probability function. And that is the first step, we will get better solution for conditional probability function. But at least, very simple. Here's this part. This mechanism. This is the most important part of the talk. In functional analysis, there is two concepts of convergence. Strong convergence, convergence in functions, and that is what it is, convergence. your sequence converges to function f zero if you have integral over this, which converges to zero. That's strong mode of convergence. And with big mode of convergence, if you converge in functionals, if your sequence converges to f zero, to integral this f zero, for all functions from Hilbert space. And strong mode convergence, weak mode convergence, that is just theorem of Cauchy. And for function belong to compact, weak mode convergence implies strong mode of convergence. So you have two different mode of convergence, which do the same job. But in all statistical theory, we're using just strong mode of convergence, which is the weakest mode, the worst mode, and you will see why. So that is definition of weak mode of convergence. It converges to this function. But if you will use Bayesian formula, it's equal to this integral, and what is the most important, equal to p y equal one integral over that. So it means that what with weak mode of convergence for our case for conditional probability function, if our sequence of function converge to this function, to this function. But for all functions, that is definition of the mode of convergence. But we refer to set of M function. Let's take M function from this Hilbert space. As a chosen and column chosen predicate, and the subset of functions f of x for which the following M equality holds, we call admissible set of functions. What it means? It means that if we have some M functions and there exists weak mode of convergence, we can consider from set of, say, Hilbert functions, only such functions which satisfy this equation, satisfy this M equations. And that equations is defined by our phi functions. What it means that we can select, if we given predicate, if we given a function, it can be any function, because the convergence is true for all functions of Hilbert space. We selecting of admissible set of functions. It is for the first time in history of learning, we can talk about selection of admissible set of functions. What means selection of admissible set of functions? Say, in neural network, they construct a neural net. That is selection of set of functions. So if you have a form to do it through predicate, you have a strong weapon to select good set of functions, and we will talk about that. But let us replace integral with sum. We will have this equation for our stuff. So in vector notations, it is the same notations, y equal y1, yl. F capital from F is f of x1, f of xl. For any function, we have that. And this is new. We take k, gk, and take vector over value of k in x1 in xl. The construction everywhere is the same. For you have function, and then you from function compute vector using your training data. So in this notation, we can describe admissible set of function in very nice form. So our admissible set of function should satisfy these equalities. And we call this admissible set of function statistical invariance for conditional probability, because this is true only for conditional probabilities. It was derived like that. We use Bayesian formula over here, which is true for conditional probability. So I don't know how to do it for regression. But for conditional probability, you can do it. You have this way to select your admissible set of functions. Let me explain what is that. In English, there is a proverb saying, if it looks like a duck, swims like a duck, and quack like a duck, then it's probably duck. That is exactly statistical invariant. So animal which look like a duck, what it means, it is you take ducks and look like average of duck, center of mass of duck, and you can compute center of mass of duck from your observations. Here your observation, here your predicated y is duck or not duck. And here is conditional probability. So you pick up only that conditional probability which satisfies this equation. Or in vector format is that. You have m equations and then pick up the function which constitute admissible set of functions. But this is very general. You can say it's look like a duck, moves like a duck, and sound like a duck. Or you can say looks like a dog, like a horse, like a pig, moves like a dog, and the horse, and so on. It is general. It is predicate for any classification of any animals. It is not specifically to duck. So it is your understanding of difference between animals. I will talk about that. So it is your understanding of life. It is some general understanding. And what is predicate? It's very different from features. Why it's so? With increasing number of predicate, this is dimension of admissible set of function decrease. Why it decrease? Because you have set of predicate, you set of function which satisfy invariant, which was constructed based on this predicate. Then you introduce new invariant, new predicate and new invariant. So you select from admissible set of function, subset of function. So the more invariant you have, the smaller this dimension of set of functions. But mathematically, when you have infinite number of invariant, you have one function because it converges to one function. So it is great instrument for selecting admissible set of functions. So instead of constructing neural net, you can construct a learning machine using invariant, and we will talk about that one. Yeah. And what is features? When you're increasing number of features, this dimension increase because you have more opportunity to construct decision rule. So it is in some sense works in opposite direction. And my claim is that invariant is much richer and much more interesting than features. Now I will talk about complete solution of learning problem. Why it complete? Because it use both deconstruct convergence. There are no another way for convergence. Only two ways of convergence in Hilbert spaces exist. So if given set of function, so minimize the functional, which we define it as conditional probability functional, subject to this constraint, to our conditional probability, whatever we discussed before, we add some subset of function to minimize. This set of function now can be very general because we will decrease subset to admissible set of function using this invariant. We call this way for solving problem learning using statistical invariants. So it's for complete solution of learning problem because it use all mechanisms existing for convergence existing in Hilbert space. But again, this is very general formulation. I'm not talking in which set of function. It adds general as least square method on all this stuff, but it adds something else. But you know, sometimes you're unhappy with this equality because it comes from empirical data and maybe not exact, maybe you should say approximately equal. So to do that, let us subtract from the right-hand side of this equality, left-hand side, and make a sum and say, let this will be less than small value epsilon. And I normalized over vector of predicates. I normalized because this equality, if you multiply on any constant, you will still have equality. So it is absolutely legal direction. And I would like to, instead of functional, which is this one, and constraint, instead of this constraint, to minimize this one. So if I will use both constraints, this and this, I have to minimize in the given set of function, this functional. And again, I splitting T into parameters of algorithm. And it has this equivalent form where I have minimize this quadratic form, now not V quadratic form as before, but V plus P, where P depends on your predicate. So my goal now is to minimize in a given set of function, this functional. I can get strict solution in reproducing kernel Hilbert space. In reproducing kernel Hilbert space, again, we can take a value vector A, it is all definition, vector A, vector K, vector function K of X, it was before defined like vector functions in first coordinate and last coordinate, K is matrix, K is E, G. We define the admissible set of function as our function which has this expression, this is a null parameters, and B it is AK, A transform AK less than B, and we have invariants. So we would like to solve these equations, which is conditional, estimate conditional probability, under constraint this, and constrain that is invariant. And we have closed form solution, that our solution is equal to A, this coefficient on the K. This is learning using statistical invariants. This is conditional probability, which we derived before. But we have corrections because we introduced not only conditional probability, minimizing this in set of functions. If you minimize this in set of functions, you have conditional probability. But now we're minimizing this in this set of functions under this constraint. So we have whatever we got before for conditional probability plus some corrections. And this is exactly the same formula which we got for conditional probability. This is corrections. And to obtain coefficients for correction terms, we have to solve m linear equations with m unknown. So everything is in closed form. So we have a relaxed solution. We would like to minimize this functional under this constraint. It is the same. In the case when we don't have strict equality, but it is approximate equality. So we would like to minimize this under this constraint. So again, you have this solution, and that is how to compute this coefficient. It has a closed form solution. So that means that we completely solve our own learning problem. And only questions left, how to choose predicate? What is predicate? Okay, let me, before I will go to predicates, I would like to show you example how it can be applied to neural net, for example. So this is what neural net does. It minimizes this functional. Here it is in identity matrix. And F capital over F is a set of piecewise linear function F, which realized by a neural net. So they use back propagation, forward propagation, back path propagation, and update parameters. Now we would like to minimize this functional, which instead of identity matrix has some matrix which depend on V matrix and P matrix and predicate matrix. It so happened that we can apply to this functional the same back propagation method. And it is very simple way to compute it. You just, instead of in back propagation method, instead of vector, this is last layer, y is target value, and this u is what comes from last layer. Instead of this vector, you're using this vector, which corrected by matrix Vp. So let's see what's happened if we will do that. And that is what's happened. We're minimizing this instead of whatever does neural net. And we take very simple predicate. We consider problem which M is digit recognition. U it is, say it is N by N pixel, which describes your digit. You just take one. Predicate function is one. What it means? It means one multiplier of your conditional, of your function of interest should be equal to L1. L1, it is number of element of training set for the first class. So you're using not all functions, but only those of them which sum of value of this function in training data will give you exact L, exact one. So we make a setting, V equal identity, we don't want to compute this. and we have one predicate and LT 1000, 100 per class, batch is 60, just come to NIST, to NAC labs, they have very nice deep neural network. And we just in a couple of hours constructed new machine, but neural net. Neural net use this identity matrix and we use this matrix. And we got this result. The worst, it is probability of error on the y-axis. And on the x-axis is a number of epoch. So this is neural network. And this is VP neural network. It's immediately become better and it gives improvement. Just one invariant gives improvement 0.2%. But it is reasonable invariant. So let's consider the bad invariant. Yeah, I took a picture. U is a two-dimensional digit description. It is n by n pixels. And I consider the expansion on the cosine in one coordinate and another. It's just sum. And got this predicate. Again, the same setting. And what we got? We got slightly improvement over neural net, but not too much. But it definitely everywhere it is bad. Okay, it was bad predicate, and it gives improvement, but small improvement. You remember that according to theory, any stupid phi will make improvement because weak convergence should go for all functions in Hilbert space. You cannot do worse. You cannot hit the method. Then we decided, let's do 16 bad predicate. What's happened? So, and what was cosine m and cosine n, m along one coordinate, m along another coordinate, m n from one to four. So again, the same setting, and you have big improvement, more than 0.5%, 0.6% improvement. So I finished this part. And do you have questions? Then let me talk about last part. First of all, I would like to summarize in some sense. According to any learning theory, in order to find function which minimizes test error, one has to select set of admissible functions. Make structure of the set of functions, find the appropriate element of the structure, and find function which minimizes bound. This is good bound number. So if you're using memorizing term, you will have just this, okay, you see H over L. Such scheme contain two selection problems. One selection problem is difficult part, philosophical. How to select admissible set of functions? It can be any, because you're looking for the best function in a given set of functions. And second is mathematical problem, easy problem. And actually, all guys who doing statistical learning theory in all textbook, they doing nothing, but they solving easy mathematical part of problem. There are no single theoretical result how to select admissible set of functions. It's only possible if you will use weak mode of convergence. Let me give you illustration. Suppose you have picture 60 by 60 black and white pixels. That's your image. Then there exist 256 different pictures. L2 to the 256 different two class classification problems. Let the set of admissible classification group contain M rule. To select from this set the desired rule based on training example, one need L log M examples, because in the best case, guarantee case, one example can reduce your set of functions by two, by half. So if you have M example, if you have M functions, you need logarithm M of examples to pick up one function. When the admissible function is not too big, say less than 2 to the million, or 2 to the 1000, it doesn't matter. There exists mathematical method how to find the best function in the set. And that is what people talking in learning theory. If M is too big, say 2 to the 256, one cannot find the desired function using reasonable number of examples. Because if you will take logarithm of that, you will have 2 to the 256. That means that you should show all examples. You remember it was no free lunch theorems. It's exactly what it says. So no free lunch, it means that somebody gave you, somebody solved from you, for you, the most difficult problem. The choice of the admissible set of function is the first selection problem. To solve it, one should know something. It is not a statistical problem. It is a philosophical problem. But one invariant can decrease a lot of set of functions. You remember predicate for animal classification. If it looks like a dark horse pig, moves like a dark horse pig, then it probably is a dark horse pig. We choose admissible set of solution. As admissible set of solutions, those functions that satisfy invariant constructed based on chosen collection of predicate. Adding new invariant lead to decreasing set of admissible functions. Then it will require less example to know. One can say any predicate. For example, you can say place chess like horse. It is okay. Formally, it is okay. But it is useless. It is not decreasing your set of functions. You can say it is better predicate. Eating like duck, horse, or pig, or sitting like a duck, or sleeping like a duck, horse, or pig. To find small set of useful predicate, one should understand reality. Somehow to understand the reality to give you this set of predicate. Intelligent learning use small number of good predicate to construct invariant. They select a set of admissible functions with small VC dimension. This allow use small number of training data. You can say that in literature, in world literature, there exists example when people give a predicate. In 1928, Vladimir Prop published book Morphology of Russian Folklore, where he described 31 elements of Russian folk tales. So, and then later people realized that in literature, theater, films, television series, game, everywhere working this predicate, and there are no new predicates. That means that 31 predicate which absorbed a prop from his understanding of life was enough to describe the structure of human relationship. And it is small amount of predicate. Another example. Predicate for conflict resolution. 500 years BC, the book The Art of the War attributed to Sun Tzu was written. This book contains 36 strategic schemes. It's studied now in academia because it has nothing to do with specific way of war. It changed a lot during 2000 years. And it also studied a lot in military school, in school of business and management. And you probably cannot add too many strategic schemes to this 36 predicate. It reflects understanding of resolution of conflict situation. So the idea is that there exists small amount of predicate which describe our life and reflect understanding of our life. And what is the challenge? There exists 10 class digit recognition and deep neural networks using 60,000 training examples, 6,000 per class, achieve say 0.5% of error rate. The same neural net using 100 examples was able to achieve much worse, 3.2% of accuracy. But using 16 predicate, just occasionally predicate, we improve more than 0.5% of that. The challenge is to obtain the same level of accuracy as deep neural network with learning using statistical invariant, using 100 times fewer examples, 600 instead of 60,000. But just introduce predicate. The hope is that predicate that use in digit recognition, the specific digit, which reflect our understanding of digit images, will be also useful in 2D black and white graphical pattern recognition, as how it was with props predicate. So that is the challenge to do that. I introduced 12 predicates, which describe level of symmetry. When you're looking on they reflect my understanding of similar images. What is predicate? What is move, quark, and look? For images. Can you say it? If you can, that it is not for images, or for images of digit, it's for everything. So you can use this, but maybe it should be added something else, or maybe somebody has a better suggestion. Which predicate use to use a small amount of training data to achieve high level performance. So my message is following, that people don't need a lot of data to learn. They need to understand what they want. There exists some small part of predicate in human history. It was one predicate which prop suggested, another predicate which Sun Tzu suggested. I don't know, maybe exists something else I am not specialist in philosophy of this stuff. So, and that is the way how to do that. You see that there is a connection between intelligence, artificial intelligence, and learning problem. Now to learn, you should know something which is higher level than just selection of one function from admissible second function, which is just mechanical part of the job. So they want to say that I was surprised when I realized that philosophy of learning method considered in this talk can be described in style of Plato, ontology of the world. How understand Plato, how world is built? He understand in the following way, that world contains four parts. The highest part is world of super ideas. Second, world of ideas. Then world of things. And then the most on the bottom, material world. From whatever I told you, world of ideas, not super ideas, I will talk later about super ideas. World of ideas contains finite set of predicate, which reflect understanding of event of material world. Predicate are projected in world of things. Things that is our examples. Where they construct invariants. And as soon as they construct invariants, they construct admissible set of functions. Then material world solves the problem of interest in the constructed by set of things, by world of things, set of admissible functions. World of super ideas select predicate. And how it does, nobody knows. The new idea in such Plato type model is the interaction of world of ideas with world of things in material world. The mechanism of transformation of predicate into specific invariants and then into admissible set of functions. And the mystery is how super ideas select predicates. So I finished my talk. Are you with me?
Yes.
Good.
Thank you, Professor Vamik.
I ready to answer questions if you have.
Thank you very much, Professor Vapnik. Great talks. Anybody wants to ask questions or any comments or anything, or you can type on a chat if you want to add something, or raise a hand maybe. Can I start? Maybe very simple question: have you written a paper on the subject or several papers, especially as the second and the third and the fourth and the fifth part?
Yeah. I wrote paper, but maybe it's not so clear in papers. A lot of technical details. It is Vapnik Ismailov. You can check it. Couple of papers, please. Now we'll be preparing more general paper, maybe we'll publish it soon.
What, including the part five, which is for philosophy?
Including part five. For me, the most important is part five, because part recognition is not so simple problem. Whatever we're doing, it is very, very low and very stupid level. Given admissible set of functions, that's mathematical problem to select, to pick up functions from this just technical part without seeing all the picture. have it complicated.
Okay. Anybody else wants to ask a question?
Oh, hello. Hi. Very interesting talk. So is you can formulate translation invariance as a predicate?
What means translation of invariance?
Oh, just in, I mean, for example, a convolutional neural net, you can move the digit around. And
you know, convolution is just one invariant.
Yes. Yeah, right. Right. Okay.
So I can just write it down.
Yep.
I will say what means convolution, and among many invariants, keep this one. That's it.
Right. Mm-hmm. And then the new objective function incorporating the invariant, this is all based on sums once you have your neural network, right? So you can just implement it and propagate.
Yeah. No. Cool. First of all, I am not fond of neural network.
I know.
Yes, and what is wrong with the neural network? From very beginning, I said that you can control by, compressing with the dimension. In neural network, you can control nothing. You cannot control capacity, you cannot control VC dimension. By the way, neural network somehow has memorization part of neural network. Mm-hmm. People from neural network, they saw that. But it's not specific for neural network how they teach it. So how they are writing VI. I gave you example of support vector machine, which does the same. Mm-hmm. And it is very general. And I told you that if as soon as you use memorizing kernel, you will always in this situation.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So do that.
Mm-hmm.
So, but what is wrong with neural networks that you cannot control? Neural network. That just this idea control is some sort of everything, but who knows what is that?
Thank you.
If they achieve memorization, then the only what they do, they must to do, mm-hmm. according to general principle. They have memorized set of function, and they should compress with the dimension. How they do that? So if you not compress with the dimension, you will separate data, but it happened nothing.
Any more questions? Can I ask you this very last sentence you said, how super ideas select predicates? But if number of predicates is a limited number, 31 in case of fairy tales or thereabouts, why not just to make it each of them to check it, and by looking in each of them will be clearer which one to choose?
No, that's exactly what on the verbal level, exactly what people are looking for. But now if you're doing formally mathematical, you should describe in mathematical formulas what means this. But how to select predicate, I don't know. And even Probe did not select predicate. He took it from existing literature, from, I believe, 600 Russian folk tales, and somehow subtract 31 predicate. And surprisingly, in just last 40, 50 years, people realize that is understanding of whole human lives, and there are no different description of human lives, Genesis. And why people study 2000 years old book about strategy. It's word different, arm different, but principles is the same. By the way, Plato did not know how to super ideas select predicate. And that is the biggest difference. But Plato says that material world costs nothing. It is not, I forgot that. He used special word.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. any question, any further questions or anything? There is a Chris's question, translation invariance in a predicate. That's been answered probably.
Well, the translation predicate of invariant, it's very simple. Mm-hmm. If you know predicate, you know.
Mm-hmm.
That is your predicate,
mm-hmm.
P. Mm-hmm. And you make some. You're looking for this conditional probability. You can compute this, right? You know phi. You make average for, it looks like the center of mass of this predicate. And you want to solve this equation in the way that all your phi, f, must be such that they satisfy this.
Mm-hmm.
That's formally. But now you can do whatever you want.
Okay.
you cannot hurt yourself because according to Weak convergence, every phi is good. But your goal is to select the smallest amount of phi, which gives you smallest dimension. But it could be not mathematical problem because you remember this illustration. So you should select this is amount of your different pictures. And this is amount of your problems on these pictures. So admissible set of function M, if it M big, but not too big, that log of M is reasonable value, then you can plot. But if you compare it with this value N, it's just tiny amount. And that jump from this to this.
Yeah.
Super ideas how to do that. By the way, super ideas sometime Plato called God. But I don't know, but people did it. Probe did it and the strategists did it. And maybe many other guys did it, I don't know, but I'm not so familiar with world literature.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, if no more questions, maybe we can stop at this point and people can write to you, Vladimir, with their comments or questions if they have. But meanwhile, thank you very much again for very interesting and fascinating and challenging talk.
My interest. Okay.
Well, finish if you want to finish. What do you want to say?
I want to say that for me the most important part is the last part. That there exists big philosophy about learning. Learning comes to very general philosophy, which suggests Plato.
Mm-hmm.
When I for the first time learned about Plato, I was laughing. It was a stupid thing. Now I understand that what means world of ideas and why they work. It is just on the Plato recognition. And it means that we can understand what is intelligence involved.
Yeah, well, there must be some other people who, since Plato, trying to develop these ideas further.
Let me tell my opinion. I think that learning theory is done. The what in this fashion. The only left what how to choose predicate. Because if you know how to choose predicate, the rest is formal and you cannot improve because you use all way for convergence.
Mm. Well, on this challenging note, we can stop.
Okay, at this point. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much indeed. Thank you.